Hello, I'm Charlie Brooker and you're watching Newswipe, a programme all about what's been going on, like this. Nifty blue masks tipped to be the must-have look of the season. Astonishing scenes as supermarket's new Pamplona Taste the Bull range proves too fresh for comfort. And Sky News cheers the nation with an account of an eye-watering escape for a hero.
A British soldier serving in Afghanistan has had a miraculous escape when a bullet passed straight through his helmet.
Yep, that's the way the world goes. But first this.
You know what's boring? Facts are boring. There's no emotion with facts, no soul, just cold, hard data. If facts were a person, they'd be the most tediously conservative little tag nut in the universe. The sort of slappable milquetoast who thinks Coldplay are edgy and finds chicken korma a bit hot.
That's hot.
The news essentially consists of an unending list of boring facts, and that's precisely what it used to look like.
The earliest BBC TV news broadcasts consisted essentially of radio bulletins being read over still images.
The news bosses at the time thought the addition of moving images would distract viewers from the factual content.
Instead, a faceless announcer would talk about the story and then introduce a bit of film at the end of it.
Here is an illustrated summary of the news. It'll be followed by the latest film of events and happenings at home and abroad.
Gradually, a bit more artistry seeped in and visuals became more snazzy, although making them was a pain. Because for years, news graphics had to be laboriously crafted by hand until the 80s, when the Quantel paint box arrived. This allowed the graphics department's imaginations to run riot, even going so far as to put a head on Iran and make it spin around a bit. Wahey! Now, if you think of the raw factual content of the news as an instruction sheet, which you will because that's what I'm telling you to do, then news graphics are supposed to function as the helpful wireframe diagrams that help put the verbal content into context.
Now, that may well have been the case back in ye good old days when the visuals literally were graphs and diagrams.
But now, watching the news is a bit like trying to follow a set of instructions written in a garish font on a belly dancer's undulating torso while a psychopath stands in the room playing the trombone in your ear. Today's CGI visuals punctuate the news like knowing Terry Gilliam sequences in an old Monty Python episode. Occasionally, they go so overboard, you could be forgiven for thinking you've tuned into a whole new surreal animation series.
Here, she survived by eating dead crabs and hunting wild goats.
Anyway, if you want to see news graphics at their most unhinged, just wait till the next election.
We all know what an election looks like.
Albert Edward Arstall.
Liberal.
4,237.
Oh, you know, we promised when we started doing this series that we'd cut down on all the loser masturbating alone in his flat stuff we used to do in Screen White, but come on, look at this. Oh, God. Oh, I'm going to have to sit on my hands.
8,000.
At heart, elections consist of the dullest facts of all, numbers.
Consequently, news coverage of elections goes absolutely mental in a desperate bid to distract you from how tedious it actually is.
They do this partly by building a stupid great desk for the host to sit behind, showing off like they're in a sci-fi film.
Conservative share of the vote in Torbay, static.
God, this is the most boring Star Trek episode I've ever seen. But they mainly do it with visual trickery.
Visual trickery began with the swingometer, which was neat, simple, and easy, which is precisely why it couldn't last. In later years, come election night, Peter Snow was the mad Professor Yaffle of the graphics lab.
His number crunching aside, started out relatively sober and clear.
In 1987, he had a thing that looked a bit like the departures board in a train station.
Look at all that blue right the way across.
And in what was a hugely cutting-edge move for the late 80s, some real-time bar graphs, which excitingly could revolve a bit as they ventured upwards.
And that's exactly the way you'd twist one if you were trying to work it up your arse. Not that anyone would want to work one of those up their arse. I don't know why I brought that up, it's just weird. Let's move on.
Yes. Anyway, zip forward to 2001 and Snow's graphics card got upgraded, ending the tyranny of easy-to-understand two-dimensional visuals forever as the swingometer floated off the wall like a haunted clock face.
And it won't this time be a pendulum that moves among the MPs, scything them up and down. It'll be a laser beam, zapping them from blue to red and red to blue.
Reality had entirely sodded off by 2005 as Snow got devoured completely by The Matrix, and the election as a whole became the world's most underwhelming PlayStation 2 game.
Michael Howard coming up now. This is our first forecast. Could change if the light goes on.
Oh, imagine that, having your very own Michael Howard that would just do anything you wanted it to. Oh, I'm going to have to sit on my hands again. Oh. Still, the most excruciating moment ever in election night graphicry didn't belong to Peter Snow. No, that honour went to Jeremy Vine, who took over holodeck duties for the 2008 local elections.
Viewers were treated to a cringe-inducing CGI live-action hybrid starring Vine in a pink shirt tucked into his pants, a virtual Nick Clegg gunslinger thing, oh, and a terrible, terrible, terrible Texan accent. Ugh.
Say here, Damble, this here is a shootout saloon.
You know, this is so bad it wouldn't even pass muster on Italian television.
What happens when I shoot this tin can?
The 30,000 viewers die of shame on your behalf.
26%!
By the time the US election rolled round, Vine seemed somewhat chastened and was largely restricted to dealing with actual figures, albeit ones that floated in the air for no f***ing reason whatsoever.
Fortunately for fans of outright idiocy, over-the-top American news network CNN went one better by creating the world's first news hologram.
How is this night for you?
Feels good being here in Chicago. All this technology, I'm being beamed to you like it's Star Wars and stuff.
Yeah, it looks like basically like exactly like in Star Trek when they would beam people down. That's what it looks like right here.
Yeah, it looks just like that episode where they found the unconvincing flickery blue sprite.
Yeah, but yeah.
What's more, graphics aren't just for the hosts to play with these days, thanks to brilliant websites like Sky News Online's Fritzel Interactive. Yes, it's Joseph Fritzel's house, and you can click your way round it. Why, it's so simple even a child could use it. Anyway, with all this visual fun, no wonder TV and the internet have slaughtered the traditional print media. We'll have more on that later.
It's been a busy old week for the world, but not all of it's been serious. Here's the week in bullshit.
Hullabaloo! As Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad brings gripping controversy to an otherwise dull afternoon on BBC News by introducing a knockabout air of anti-Semitism into a UN conference on race, upsetting Zippo and Coco here in the process.
The end result was startlingly like a jongleur's open mic spot gone horribly wrong.
Guys, did you hear the one about the Jew? Okay, you heard that one. Anyone here from Israel?
Money getting, and the nation's anxious eyes turned to Alistair Darling's face, arms and body as he prepared the most important budget ever.
Sky helped build the anticipation with a series of exciting VTs in which celebrities told us what they'd do if they were Chancellor. I say celebrities, I mean people like Nick Leeson. He was pictured standing up the side of a cliff like a financial cormorant.
Their failure to pay attention has brought Britain to the edge of the financial precipice.
The thrills swelled the next day thanks to Ronnie Wood's estranged wife, Jo Wood, seen here standing in a wood.
In a bid to encourage people to cultivate veg in their window boxes, she said she'd abolish VAT on grow-your-own seeds.
Tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads would soon sprout from our flats and houses.
Hang on, did she say tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads?
Tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads.
Oh, I thought so, yeah. It's my favourite vegetable, that. The salad vegetable.
The day after Joe's economic revelations, Roger Daltrey rocked up, standing in a hospital.
The lead singer of The Who, standing in a hospital corridor, it's like he's Doctor Who. Doctor Who. I don't know why I bother with you.
He used his slot to plug the Teenage Cancer Trust, which he's a patron of, and that's fair enough, so we're not going to take the piss. Fortunately, the next day's entry required us to be less earnest as former jewellery magnate Gerald Ratner outlined his plans while underwhelmingly superimposed on a cheap fold-out projector screen in a variety of locations for no apparent reason whatsoever while people wandered by ignoring him.
If I was Chancellor...
Never mind if you were Chancellor, you're a magic talking rectangle and no one's paying you any f***ing attention.
Class dismissed.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Chancellor of the Exchequer. The final Alistair Darling wannabe was Neville Staple. Yes, Neville Staple, you know, from the specials. He sang on Ghost Town, and that's why he'd make such a good Chancellor of the Exchequer.
If I was Chancellor, I'd be bloody worried about what's happening today.
Come the day itself, Sky reflected the austere belt-tightening mood of the nation by cracking out the exciting Skycopter to follow Darling the few hundred metres from Downing Street to Westminster. They also wheeled out lots of grubby urban Banksy-style graphics and held scintillating interviews with the stars.
What did you make of the budget? Do you feel, as a pensioner, better off at the end of it all?
Hang on a minute, is that, it's Victor Meldrew's wife, I don't believe it. Do you get it? I don't, oh. Just leave me alone. Away from Sky, the BBC covered the Moneygeddon budget by highlighting the toxic state of the economy, while Five News, which is in no way a dumbed-down source of current affairs, highlighted the seriousness of Darling's debt crisis by illustrating it in the most bizarre manner possible.
But this year, Alistair Darling appears a lonely figure at the mercy of events, controlled by forces which give him hardly any freedom of action.
God, you know, TV fakery really has gone too far.
Yes, they made a lovely little puppet show featuring an unbelievably cheap Alistair Darling marionette apparently made by a psychopath. And they got their money's worth. We saw him enjoying the riverside and having a shit in a field and caressing his bright red box and walking gaily down the road and camping it up at a building site and standing on a wall and sitting at the wheel of a car and chatting up some birds and waving his money around and impishly wagging his eyebrow and going mental at a garage and being shunned in a pub and telling off a silly man in the foreground and walking past Whitehall and all confusing a bystander, and then getting a little migraine before giving up and cutting back to the studio.
Andy, let's talk more about national debt.
No, Andy, let's talk more about what the f*** you were doing with that puppet.
These days, if some major news event happens, chances are you'll find out about it on the internet or via a text message. But once upon a time, the news used to be printed on sheets of paper using something called ink. And these newspapers were apparently a primary source of current affairs. It used to be the case that papers would report things that may have happened, a week ago, but that was okay because the world ran at a slightly more sedate pace back then. Since the beginning of the 20th century, the press has been forced to adapt in the face of emerging whippersnapper technologies. Radio had some impact, but when TV appeared, summarising the news in a visually appealing way and drawing millions of viewers in the process, the press was forced to switch focus away from breaking traditional stories and towards snazzy photographs and human interest pieces.
The advent of the internet and a collapse in advertising revenue has massively accelerated the newspaper's transformation from news vessels to lifestyle comics.
The mid-market press, for example, is obsessed with scare stories, house prices and moral campaigns, campaigning in particular being a goldmine for papers as it creates a simple narrative of its own that can often yield palpable results.
The BBC's terrified of the Daily Mail, for instance, which has been campaigning against it for years.
In fact, if you imagine this harrowing footage represents the relationship between the BBC and the press, then the Mail is basically Trevor and the Beeb is Little Mo, but with less balls. Meanwhile, the red tops have become violently dispiriting celebrity gossip rags, filled with pictures of starlets clambering out of cars outside a nightclub, taken by a paparazzi scumbag, literally lying on the ground amongst the fag butts and the dog shit, in the hope of spotting a glimpse of lady pants. The quality press, for its part, has a demented emphasis on opinion pieces headed by photographs of people grinning like idiots or looking constipated or pulling embarrassing warthog scowls. And when they're not full of that, they're running wanky lifestyle features about which expensive designer shoe is going to go best with your organic food delivery, or they're bombarding you with free bloody wall charts like that's going to improve your stinking life. Yeah, a bloody wall chart, that's going to be good, isn't it? Why don't you stick that on your stupid bloody wall, you prick? Go on, do that, look at that, see how much better that makes your life, you c***! You c***!
Of course, that's just the print editions I'm caricaturing there. It's a different kettle of chips online, which is where the papers are hoping their future lies.
All the major newspaper brands are now also thrusting multi-platform thingamajigs replete with moving pictures, message boards and interactive widgets. All of that costs money, not enough of which is being generated by the websites at the moment.
As the money runs out, titles are cutting back and many local papers are closing entirely. In short, being a newspaper journalist right now must be about as much fun as gargling cold cow piss for a living.
Beleaguered though it may be, the press still exerts a huge influence over many aspects of British behaviour, especially in the corridors of power.
The media and the powers that be, the powers that be and the media, just how much in cahoots are they? Here's veteran political journalist Peter Oborne with his view. It's his view.
The collusion between media and government stretches down to a very, very detailed and precise level. Let me give you one example. Several years ago, the Sun newspaper launched a campaign against asylum seekers. Didn't like them very much, felt that they were abusing the system. That apparently was very critical of the government. And they launched their campaign, and at the end of their campaign, they had an interview with the then Home Secretary, David Blunkett, who made certain concessions, said the Sun was right about asylum seekers, and so the Sun could claim some form of victory. I got hold of the Downing Street grid, in which they laid out in advance future events. What was fascinating was that the Downing Street grid, prepared in advance of the Sun campaign, had the Sun campaign on it. down to the day when David Blunkett would give his interview. So what the Sun did, which appeared to Sun readers to be a spontaneous attack on government policy and asylum seekers, was actually an orchestrated performance with Downing Street, which excluded Sun readers. And it's all a performance, it's all choreographed. And it's quite disturbing, I think, for British democracy.
Whatever happens with papers, the influence of the blogosphere is on the rise, as clearly illustrated by the recent dismal case of Damien McBride, or Damien McPoison, or Dirty McMuck, or whatever they're calling him today. Damien McBride was Gordon Brown's special advisor, or attack dog, as the news christened him in a series of rather nauseating headlines. Although he doesn't really look like an attack dog, more like a nodding dog.
You know, like the one from those cheerful and chummy insurance ads. He looks a bit like you, doesn't he?
Oh, yes.
For somebody apparently so important, it was strange the news had such little footage of him, almost as though they'd been ignoring his existence for years. They had to slow down and highlight the meagre clips they had just so you could pick him out in the crowd.
Watching it was a bit like playing Where's Wally, but starring a small pink moon. Even before the smear scandal broke, it was fair to say politicians have never been quite as unpopular as they are now.
In fact, recent scientific studies show conclusively that even glancing at a politician causes the average citizen to vomit uncontrollably. There are a few notable exceptions, but on the whole, they're less popular than shingles. Anyway, over the past few years, the Labour Party has watched in dismay as right-wing political blogs have thrived online, with perhaps the biggest turn in their punch bowl being Guido Fawkes' Westminster Gossip and Sleaze site, which is run by a mysterious silhouetted figure seen here having his cover blown on Newsnight some time back.
Why do you insist on this preposterous disguise?
Well, it's so I can go undercover.
No, I saw you at a lunch once where everybody else was in a tie. You were wearing a rugby shirt and somebody said, that's Paul Staines, he's Guido Fawkes. And I said, get away, is it? He looks a bit of a prat.
Yes, Guido is actually a guy called Paul Staines, played here by a sort of made-over Oliver Hardy.
He claims not to be a Tory, incidentally, but a broadly anti-politics libertarian. Although whatever he is, he certainly seems to be a bit of a tit.
Sometimes he does hilariously arrogant things, like posting this charming snap of him enjoying a cigar on a city balcony overlooking the G20 protests.
Still tit or not, the papers are certainly scared of him, and he gets results.
For instance, Peter Hain resigned after Guido's revelations about campaign donations.
The Guido Fawkes site, and others like it, routinely bristle with comment, innuendo, criticism and boneheaded abuse, just like any other message board on the internet, or any newsroom, or this show.
Anyway, Labour were keen to launch a snarky countersite of their own called Red Rag. Derek Draper was going to oversee it, and Damien McBride sent him an email suggesting a bunch of pungently repellent smear stories to run on the thing.
Somehow they ended up in the hands of Guido Fawkes, he handed them to the papers, and boom, it exploded all over the news like a balloon full of hot sewage.
McBride resigned soon after, blaming Guido Fawkes for not playing fair. Oh, and Derek Draper had a little moan about it too.
What a world we live in where private personal emails can be used in this way.
Oh, boo-hoo. Actually, with Guido Fawkes on one side and the likes of Damien McBride on the other, it's been like watching two immense monsters made of shit fighting each other in some sort of f***ed Godzilla movie. Except, of course, no matter how big an ass Guido Fawkes may or may not be, he's not a civil servant with wages paid by the taxpayer, which is what McSpunk was.
Once the story broke, the focus quickly shifted to whether Gordon Brown would apologise or not. First, he expressed regret in a series of letters, but that wasn't good enough for the Tories. The pressure mounted on Brown to say sorry properly, which he seemed comically incapable of doing.
Prime Minister, will you apologise for the Damien McBride emails?
Gordon Brown.
As the days dragged on, the Tories got to set the news agenda.
David Cameron seized the opportunity to liven up an already lively day for Sky News by mentioning the word change about a billion times.
What this whole episode demonstrates is the need for change. Not change in the special advisor's code, but change in the culture at number 10 Downing Street. Change of government. We need change in order to change the culture. Change, and we need some change.
Or change the record.
Then Francis Maude depressed those same Sky viewers with his doubt that Gordon Brown would ever say sorry.
He's not going to apologise, we know that. Gordon Brown's constitutionally incapable of saying sorry.
Although a few days later, that's precisely what he did.
Well, I'm sorry about what happened.
Yes, it was such a humiliating climb down for the Brown minister. Even a stranger in a hard hat in the background who wandered into shot had to piss off out of sheer embarrassment.
So, why did this whole thing happen? Well, as I see it, partly because blogs are becoming more influential, but mainly because politicians themselves seem so indistinguishable and remote from the voters that most political arguments now come across as exercises in opportunist point scoring conducted in management wonk speak.
In fact, watching politicians debate the issues today feels a bit like sitting through the grinding, egomaniacal boardroom bickering sequences from The Apprentice.
Oh, that's interesting. I thought I caused 8 arguments.
Yeah, you did.
Politicians even seem to want to dominate the agenda when they haven't got anything to say.
If you just let me get a word in, I would be very happy to answer your question. I mean, would you like me to do that?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Thank you.
The paucity of ideological debate is partly the fault of the news, which favours character and drama over dusty old politics. It means our MPs often end up essentially debating nothing more than who's the smelliest, and the public don't like it. No wonder MPs recently overtook paedophiles on the National Bogeyman Index, which tracks unpopular hate figures.
So in summary, the press is defunct, people are awful, and Westminster is doomed. But never mind, here's a funny photo of a duck to cheer you up, and a silly noise.
Here's a short piece from Nick Davis, the author of Flat Earth News, with his view on how some elements of the press gather their news stories.
For years, most Fleet Street newspapers have been using illegal techniques to get access to information, which they call, in their internal office jargon, the dark arts. The more you look at Fleet Street's use of the dark arts, the dirtier it gets. There are examples of them phone tapping, which is serious illegal stuff. Fleet Street got obsessed with Angus Dayton's sex life, which is a sad story in itself. And they had a British telecom engineer place a listening device in the junction box near his home in order to listen to his phone calls. And that's a straightforward breach of the law by the engineer. They've also started using things called, you know, Trojan horse emails, where the journalist sends the target an email which has an attachment which opens and then copies everything in the hard disk and relays it on to another email address which can't be traced to the newspaper but gives them everything that's on the hard disk. Part of the dark arts tradition in Fleet Street has been hacking into mobile phones. And this is a major industry, although Fleet Street continues to deny it. Journalist Clive Goodman got caught hacking into the mobile phone messages of 3 people on the staff of Prince Charles. And because it was the royal family, the police reacted. So Goodman got busted along with the private investigator who'd been doing the stuff for him, and they both ended up in prison. So the private investigators who work for Fleet Street basically have 2 techniques, bribing and blagging. So bribing simply means you hand over a brown envelope full of cash to whoever it is, the civil servant who can get you into the Social Security database or the police officer who can get you into the police national computer. It's a criminal offence, but hey, who's asking questions? Or blagging. Blagging means that the private investigator cons the people who look after the database into releasing the information, and they're very skilled at it. There was one newspaper who had a former actor who was like their own personal blagger, who learnt how to speak with the kind of internal language of a British telecom engineer. So a lot of what we know about the dark arts comes from a raid by the Information Commission on the home of a private investigator in Hampshire called Steve Whittemore. He set up a network of people who could get him access to these secret record bases. So he had somebody in the DVLA so he could convert a car number into a name and an address. He had somebody who had access to the police national computer. He had other people in Social Security. Newspapers were ringing him up for illegal stuff, and within half an hour he's delivering it for a fee. The Information Commission basically didn't have enough money to put the newspapers who had paid him in the dock. People are very frightened of the bullying Fleet Street newspapers. Government in particular don't like getting into fights with newspapers, so they back off. I think that if you ask where do the dark arts come from, ultimately it is about commercial pressure. It's about trying to get stories that nobody else has without putting in the money and resources that you should. And like so much of what's gone wrong with our news organisations, ultimately it is to do with being corrupted by commercialism. And the dark arts is an example of that for sure.
Music! And Dennis Healy takes to the stage of the world's most exhilarating, heartwarming, yet paradoxically shit variety show in the most uplifting event ever captured on videographic tape.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
Now, the two astonishing things about Susan Boyle are apparently, one, that she looks a bit like a cross between a Soviet premier from the 70s crossed with a haunted tree, yet two, she manages to have above average vocal cords.
When dreams are made and used and wasted.
Except she's not that remarkable if you stop to think about it for, I don't know, 0.68 of a second. She's not got the greatest voice in the world, nor has she got the ugliest face.
Just walk into the street and you can see a woman who looks like her standing at pretty much any bus stop.
But thanks to a combination of our backward appearance-led culture and a nakedly manipulative setup VT, which made her out to be a comedy loser...
Well, I've never been married. Never been kissed.
Oh, Jim.
Susan Boyle's performance soon became the number one talking point for every tiresome prick in the land.
Before long, this cheerful highlight of one hit ITV show became the cheerful highlight of another hit ITV show called The News.
And finally, we've been humming her song around the office once again today, and it seems we are not alone. The voice and the life story of Susan Boyle have managed to lift the spirits of millions in these tough economic times.
Oh, f*** you.
Of course, the festival of patronisation didn't end there.
Yes, Susan Boyle really did practice with a hairbrush at home in West Lothian.
Yes, they showed us all round her little house in her little corner of Scotland, which all wasn't prepared for this kind of attention.
Honestly, you'd have thought they'd discovered John Merrick could juggle. Inevitably, we're also forced to listen to some choice words from Formica Face.
I honestly think it spoils people if you give them a big old makeover.
Well, like when you pump 10 gallons of Botox into their face.
But I think we'll keep her as she is for now so she doesn't have the added pressure of worrying about what she looks like.
We also heard from shit sluggo ball bags here.
I mean, look, we're in the middle of a terrible recession. A lot of people in Britain have been suffering very badly from that.
I can think of some I'd like to suffer more.
And I think what Susan Boyle has single-handedly done is bring a smile to all our faces.
And she's achieved all this in just the show's first episode. Three S's.
As well as dominating ITN's news bulletins, this feel-good story was also all over the papers, like an outbreak of some kind of Les Dawson visual spam mail. In fact, sometimes it felt like you couldn't go anywhere without seeing her face. You might as well have cut it out and stuck it on a pole and then stuck that to your forehead.
Still, if her dominance of the UK was bad enough, it got worse when the Americans got wind of her.
They managed to crank the condescension to a whole new level, patting her on the head like she was a magic baby that had learned to play the flute.
So, Susan, what a sensation this is. Do you wake up every morning now with a smile?
Or what passes for a smile on your unconventional face?
You also said to everybody that you had never been kissed.
No comment. Don't want to talk about that.
Yeah. Well, fair enough.
Tell me, Susan, can you wipe your own asshole?
Were they surprised what you could do in front of that crowd?
They're very surprised. I think they were gobsmacked.
Gobsmacked, one of my favourite British words.
I've got another British word for you, shite hawk.
Let's try and keep it ladylike.
Yeah, let's do. Okay, now just turn around for me if you will.
And do a little jig for us, like a monkey.
Anyway, this whole saga simultaneously stinks and sucks in equal measure. For one thing, it's a PR story about a not-that-remarkable event on a televised End of the Pier show starring three twats, which only became a news story because apparently it's a f***ing miracle that women who aren't conventionally attractive are also capable of exhibiting any kind of skill whatsoever.
But instead of being allowed to find this depressing, we're told that actually it provides hope for us all.
Susan Boyle has shown us that there is hope for humanity.
Basically, instead of being feel-good, this whole thing strives to make me feel unbelievably and unbearably alone on this stinking fetid kidney stone we call a planet. Still, maybe a little song will help me get through it, yeah? I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
Well, that's all we've got time for this evening, and indeed this series. Go away.
There are a few frights in store for the MP for Halton Price and Howden next tonight on BBC 4. David Davis sits down with Marcus Brigstocke in I've Never Seen Star Wars. Next.